Good morning. I'd like to take an opportunity to welcome you all to our service this morning. For those of you who normally worship with us and those who are visiting, we're glad that you're here. We'd like to make a couple announcements before we begin our worship service. Because as you can see in our bulletin, Pastor Harold and his family have accepted a call to Tillsonburg CRC in Ontario. So we're very excited for them and we wish them well as they make plans to sell their house here and buy a house in Ontario. It'll be a very busy time for them, and I think they can maybe learn from Christopher, who's already made the transition to Ontario, and he's already accepted a job there and has moved there. But maybe that was mainly to avoid having to move, pack up, and move here. But this week, we also had the opportunity to meet with our new council, and we had four new members of council. So it did take us a while to learn each other's names. Of course, we wore our name tags and played to get to know each other games at our first council meeting. But that was good to meet together. Our former council members were there as well. And I'd like to thank them for their positive attitude during this meeting. I can only expect that they were fairly sad and almost depressed for being their last meeting. But for some reason, they had a tremendous smile on their face and were almost giddy with glee. But I'm not sure they put on a brave face for one of their last council meetings. But council were... have begun our discussions on where we go from here, and we recognize that we want to learn from the experience over the last few months. And we started those discussions of where we go and when we put together a search committee, and also we had some suggestions from our church visitors of possibly using a facilitator to help us in some of these discussions, or also the maybe being able to utilize one specialized transition minister. So as council moves through these discussions, we will keep you up to date on those things. But we will now begin our worship service, and we look forward to a time of praise and time of hearing God's word. And we will begin our service with Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Please rise.
God has called us here to this place of worship.
And he calls us with these words from Psalm 98. I had a bookmark there, but I removed it.
I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. With these words, we're called to worship and declare the faithfulness of our God in this time, this morning. Let's continue doing that in a time of silent prayer, asking that God meets with us here, that we can hear his voice, and that we can be called to his service. We'll conclude that prayer by singing, "Be Still and Know." Let's come to God quietly. Here in the recognition that our God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, there's nowhere else but him to go for direction, for help, for healing and restoration. And our God greets his people saying, "Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father, from Jesus Christ our Savior and Lord, through the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit." And together we say, as God has greeted us, take this opportunity to greet one another in the name of Jesus. We're going to continue worshiping God. Our song of praise is "We Bow Down." We're going to do it a cappella. Be seated. Listen to the good news as John tells it in his first letter. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are.
The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. And that purity that God has redeemed us to in order to live is a call to love our neighbor as much as we love ourselves, a call to love our God in heaven with all of our hearts, our souls, our minds, and our strength. It's God's will for our life. We continue worshiping by singing, "There is a Redeemer," number 833 in the red hymnal. There's opportunity for the children and their teachers now to go to children's church, a time where they'll continue worshiping God and singing and hearing God's word in a way that hopefully is easy for them to experience the goodness and grace of our God. Following that, we'll have our offering. The first is for the general fund, the second for pastor church relations, a ministry of our denomination that helps when there's, particularly when there's conflict between pastors and their congregation, but also in that whole transition as people are looking for pastors and as pastors are looking for a place to serve God. And so those are where the offerings will go today. seated.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is from Acts 14, verses 8 to 18, and that can be found on page 896 in your pew Bibles. Before we read, let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us all together so that we can worship you. Please be with us as we read from your word. Please quiet our minds and open our hearts so we can hear you speaking to us through your word. Please help us take something away from today's reading and sermon and help us apply it to our everyday lives. In your name we pray. Amen. In Lystra, there sat a man who was lame. He had been that way from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet." At that, the man jumped up and began to walk. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lycaonian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas they called Zeus, and Paul they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd, shouting, "Friends, why are you doing this? We too are only human, like you. We are bringing good news, telling you to turn from these worthless things to the living God, who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. In the past, he let all nations go their own way. Yet he has not left himself without testimony. He has shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy." Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing to them. So far the reading.
Dearly loved people of God, so over the past couple of weeks, I have been in correspondence with two congregations that had called me. The one is Tilsonburg. As you know, I accepted that call, but I also had been talking to First Kingston CRC. In fact, a couple of weeks ago, I was there preaching in Kingston in that congregation. And while I was there, after the morning service, Robin and I and the kids that were with us were invited to come to a party. It was a big, swanky celebration. A woman had completed her last treatment for breast cancer, and she was rejoicing and was celebrating and had called all her friends and relatives to gather to rejoice with her that God had allowed her the health and the strength no longer to need treatments for her cancer. Pink ribbons were everywhere. And there was all sorts of people there, including her chemo buddies. You know what a chemo buddy is? That's somebody from the chair on either side of her who had gone for months and months and months experiencing the same challenges of receiving treatment together. And so she introduced this guy to me, saying, "This is the man from the chair right beside me," as we went through these chemos together. But that wasn't all of her celebration. Earlier on in the day, in the worship service in Kingston, they have a time in the worship service when anybody can come up and speak about how they've experienced God in their life in the past or what they see the Lord doing. And she stood up in church and she spoke about how she had experienced God's grace with her in a season of life in which her husband had died, a season of life in which she had gone through 2 years of treatment for breast cancer, and other things that had gone on in her life. And she praised the Lord for sustaining her through that whole experience and rejoiced with her church family how they had walked alongside of her on this journey. She was radiant with joy because God had gone with her through the valley of the shadow of death. His rod and his staff had comforted her, and she had experienced the goodness of God. What a contrast that was. Because I had that in my memory, having just experienced that. What a contrast that was to reading this passage of how the people of Lystra responded to the healing that happened right amongst them as they were standing there in the market, watching and listening. Oh, they were excited because their buddy had been healed. Somebody who had been lame since birth was now able to walk. And they were happy about that. And that is a proper response. You celebrate, you give thanks. But their response was misdirected, pointed entirely in the wrong direction. Instead of aiming their thanksgiving and their praise to the Lord of heaven and earth, they aimed it at Barnabas and at Paul, thinking that these apostles were Greek gods walking among them. It was a good response, don't get me wrong. The sacrifices, the offerings, the celebrations, it was a good response, but completely in the wrong direction. Because they have it wrong where this healing come from. And they have this mistaken identity. They're clever people, these people of Lystra. After seeing a lame man walk, they kind of figured that this comes from some divine power. And they put it together that maybe Paul and Barnabas are these gods in disguise. Not really an idea that would occur to us, is it? I mean, witnessing a miracle, we wouldn't immediately conclude that these guys must be gods, would we? But there's good reason for that conclusion. In Greek mythology, which obviously these people bought into, the stories about gods becoming like humans and walking into town weren't so rare after all. And mythology from the Greeks include these stories of gods who walked into town and got kind of upset because nobody recognized that they were gods, and so they destroyed the whole town. Maybe that's what was running through the minds of these people in Lystra, that these gods would be jealous if they weren't recognized as gods. And so out of fear, we better hurry up and offer these wreaths and offer this bull and throw a celebration. But the people of Lystra were too clever for any problems to happen, weren't they? They were on to the tricks of Zeus and of Hermes. The celebration of the lame man's healing was mixed with fear, but they were trying to do what was right. They didn't want to be destroyed like those people in the story they had heard. Hence, the priest of Zeus leading that bull into the front of the city. But fear changes the celebration altogether, doesn't it? I mean, the scripture says that true love drives out fear. But this celebration that should have been happy and full of joy was mixed with this fear that they'd get destroyed if they didn't do it properly. And then it's a really big contrast, isn't it? Between the joy and the rejoicing of this lady and her family in Kingston, done treatments and celebrating the grace of God, surrounded by her son and three daughters and a whack of grandkids, and the whole community and congregation rejoicing in God's goodness. Compare that to the apprehension in Lystra. If we don't do this properly, we're probably going to get whacked. Something worse will happen. And it took Paul and Barnabas a little while to catch on to what's going on there. There was some confusion about the languages, because Paul and Barnabas were Jewish people who had come to that town and were talking Greek to the crowds there. But the people of Lystra were from old stock that still spoke the old language from Laonia. I can't even say it. I think that Josie did a better job on that than I did. But they were raised on this idea that the gods had to be treated like grumpy two-year-olds. That if they didn't get what they wanted, they'd throw a tantrum. And so they missed out on the good news that comes here. Because Paul and Barnabas were coming with good news. The good news of Jesus' grace, the good news of Jesus' victory. And the people of Lystra needed to hear this. They needed to hear the whole story. That although the world was created good, and beautiful and abundant and productive, the world had been shattered and broken by human disobedience. The shalom of everything in its proper spot and proper relationship was marred when humankind stepped out of God's will and disobeyed the command, the instruction for holy living that they were given. Lameness is one of those symptoms. Fear, another symptom. Misdirected worship, another symptom of the stuff that's gone wrong in our world because of the brokenness. A world that's estranged from its creator. A world where there's a chasm between humankind and their God. But the good news is God's not going to leave things like that for all eternity. And so the creator of the heavens and the earth, the sea and everything in them, did take human form. He did walk into town as a mortal. But he didn't come looking for honor and glory. God came in the world with all humility. Jesus was born to poor parents in the little town of Bethlehem. And as a baby, he was laid in a manger because there's no other room for him. And Jesus came with generosity. He came to restore, to heal, to forgive. And when people didn't recognize him for who he was, he didn't respond with anger as much as he did with mercy and sadness. I know I mentioned in a sermon recently, but I can't get that picture out of my mind. Remember how Jesus came into Jerusalem on a donkey and how he was weeping? Can you go to the next slide? Because it has the words there. Here it is. As Jesus approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, "If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it's hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and circle you, hem you in on every side, because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you." A little different, isn't it, than the fears of the people of Lystra when they think the gods are among them? And yet still that the word of judgment is there, but not with anger, not with fury, not with smiting right away, but with lamenting, with mercy, with grace. That's the picture that Barnabas and Paul are trying to bring as they bring the good news. They're quick to say, don't worship us. Don't worship Zeus. Don't worship Hermes. That's the wrong direction. Oh, you need to bring thankfulness. You need to bring praise, but not here. Not in our direction. The proper direction for those responses is to give glory to God, to give glory to Jesus Christ, who became human, who took sin and guilt and brokenness upon himself, who died in the place of you for the brokenness and the sin that's part of your life, but who was raised up Lord of life so that you too could enjoy life and wholeness and shalom, everything in its proper relationship. Because you got God all wrong. You don't know what he's really like. This is what he's like. He has shown his kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in the seasons. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy. That's what God's like. But notice where these apostles start in telling the story. They can't begin with an account of Jesus' resurrection the way that Peter did in Acts chapter 2 in talking to the people of Jerusalem immediately after Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. They can't even begin the gospel story the way that Stephen did when he was on trial before the Sanhedrin, where Stephen was able to begin with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the fathers of the nation. They weren't able to start with Moses and the instructions for holy living that they gave. They weren't able to draw that whole course of history because the people of Lystra wouldn't have known what they were talking about. That wasn't their story. That wasn't their heritage. No, when they got there, Barnabas and Paul need to start even further back. They need to tell the whole story of creation, fall, redemption and recreation, that whole sweep of the story had to be explained and unpacked for the crowds in Lystra. And so they start with creation. They start with providence. Rain from heaven. Crops in the ground. Food. And filling hearts with joy. That's where this story begins. And it's important to recognize, because I had a story writing teacher? I don't know, somebody who taught me English. And they said the important part about telling a story is you have to know when to begin the story and when to end it. And the same is true when we start to unpack the gospel with people who are hungry for that good news. That we have to understand where that common ground is. For Peter, on Pentecost, he was able to start with the resurrection of Jesus because all the people who had been there, majority of them anyhow, had been there a couple weeks earlier when they had experienced Jesus' crucifixion. And so the story of the resurrection was exactly where they needed to pick up this story. They knew the rest. And Stephen, when he stood in front of the Sanhedrin and he unpacked the story, was able to build on the basis of that common understanding that all the Jews in the Sanhedrin had, that they were children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They knew the law of Moses. They tried to live and glorify God by that story. So Stephen could begin the story with that common ground. So Barnabas and Paul, standing there among the people of Lystra, holding them off from offering sacrifices to them, needed to start even back further with creation and with God's providence. And from there could go and tell the marvelous story of creation, fall, redemption, and new creation. And so that begs the question for us, as witnesses of Jesus' resurrection, as people who are telling this story to our children and to our neighbors, and for those who are hungry to hear the good news of how God is putting the world back in order again, where do you start telling this story? What's the common ground that the folks have that they're hungering for some good news in this broken world? A world where there's stuff like cancer and Alzheimer's and heart disease. The other challenges that we face. I had an uncle who died on Friday because of heart failure after a couple of years of struggling with Alzheimer's. Death sucks. It hurts. But where do you start telling the story in that situation? Because in the gospel we hear a lot about God's providence, a lot of goodness. This is a good place for Paul and Barnabas to start telling those in Lystra that while God does hold people accountable for misdirected praise, he does hold people accountable for idolatry, of giving the worship and glory and honor that belongs to God to someone or something or anything else. And while God does hold people accountable for harming each other, for abusing his good creation in people or in the environment, while that is all true, that God calls us to holiness, God is also merciful. God is also kind. God is also forgiving. It's mind-boggling, isn't it, to think of the Creator God as completely righteous, but also being merciful, also being kind? But that's that good news that we find in Paul and Barnabas' message, that healing the one man's lameness is just the tip of the iceberg of the way that Jesus has come to restore shalom, every relationship the way it should be, everything functioning exactly the way it was designed to do. And we've experienced that, we've tasted that, that we've received God's forgiveness in Jesus Christ. We've tasted the life we have as people who've been washed clean and made right with the holiness of God. And so as we taste that goodness and we taste that mercy, we are invited to rejoice and to celebrate. That's a proper response. Parties are an appropriate response to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think Alcoholics Anonymous has it correct when they celebrate the milestones of people who are resisting the addiction that they had been trapped by, that there's a one-week celebration, 1 week without giving in to that addiction, 2 weeks without giving in to that addiction, a special button because you got 4 weeks without giving in to that addiction, and a year with a birthday party and a birthday cake, and 2 years and 5 years and 10 years, celebrating the increase in shalom of people that have resisted the addiction that had caught them trapped. These milestones of healing deserve a good get-together where the story of God's providence is celebrated and shared. And as we celebrate, the direction of our praise, the direction of our thanksgiving goes to God, our Creator, our Redeemer, that we can rejoice, we can give thanks without fear, because God is the one who spreads this feast, who welcomes us to his open house of mercy, because he's making everything new. Amen. Fill thou my life, O Lord my God. Number 356 in the red hymn book. We'll stand and sing it together. Are the things that we should include in our prayer together as we go to God as a congregation, as a church family? Reasons for giving thanks or concerns? Yeah, what have you got to share?
Sean,
yeah.
My husband's brother a couple of weeks ago got diagnosed with a tumor on his leg.
Ooh.
And he's right now going for cancer treatment in Toronto. And he is 67.
Yeah, I can see that struck a chord with you when I talked about cancer treatment. Yeah. Well, thanks for mentioning it. What's your husband's brother's name? What's your brother's name?
Henry.
Henry. We'll pray for Henry. Thanks. Yeah, Jen.
Bert's mom had a bad week at the
Oh, I'm sorry, Bert. We'll pray for Bert's mom. She's had challenges this whole year so far, eh? Yeah. Yeah, Tylee. Month early. Caitlin has some complications with the pregnancy. The baby's going to come about a month early. They're going to deliver her. Just for your comfort, that child is born a month early. Renata. Yep. Yep. Which we also have experience with. Yeah. Yeah, we'll pray for Margaret. Yeah, Dirk. Yeah. Of course. We'll pray that that all goes well. Congratulations. Maya's wedding next week, Saturday. Tex.
I was thinking about two families, maybe more, that are trying to sell homes.
Yeah.
So they can proceed with their lives. My daughter, one, and your family, the other. There may be others as well.
Yep.
But God's leading them that.
Yep. We'll pray for that, sure. And Dave, yeah. Dave Van Berkel accepted a job offer that will bring him to Edmonton. And so we are grateful to God for his leading in that way and excited with you for the new start that it'll be in September, end of August. But we're going to miss you. But we'll say more about that when we actually say farewell to you, okay? Yeah. Yeah. That's good news, isn't it? I talked with her as well. It's encouraging. Yeah. Dex. Yeah, Yalcha, we're glad that you're here this morning. We missed you the last couple of weeks when you weren't here, but we're glad that you can worship with us this morning. Come to God. Heavenly Father, we bring you all of our praise and our thanksgiving for the goodness that we have enjoyed, the goodness that we received. We have food enough, most of us, and we're really thankful for that. And jobs, productive work to do, most of what that we enjoy. We're thankful for the houses that we have to live in and for your providence that we really enjoy all the good stuff we've received from you. We're especially thankful, Heavenly Father, for the news of our salvation and redemption through Jesus Christ. We're thankful for the newness that you're creating within our world. We're thankful for the way we experience that and see that within our own church family. We pray, Heavenly Father, that this gospel message can go out. We look forward to seeing the Holy Spirit working ahead of us already. And we pray for the boldness to be able to tell our story, to bear witness to what we've experienced of your forgiveness and your restoration and your renewal. Give us boldness to speak and wisdom to know where to start the story, where there's common ground, and how to invite people to join us in worshiping Jesus Christ as Lord of all creation. We pray, Heavenly Father, alongside those that are experiencing challenges with health or other concerns. We've spoken about some of it, but there's other stuff that we don't dare to bring up in a worship service like that because it cuts too deep or it seems too private. So we bring those prayers and petitions before you, but we also pray, Heavenly, for Henry, who has a tumor in his leg and faces cancer treatment. We pray that you bring healing and strength there. But even more importantly, that he can rely on you completely as his comfort in life and in death, being a faithful Savior for him. We pray for Bert's mom, Heavenly Father. She's had a rough year, sometimes better and sometimes worse. We pray that she can receive the care that she needs and that you give strength to the whole family as they walk alongside her. Tylee's sister, Caitlin, is expecting a child, and we rejoice for that. And yet there's concern for the pregnancy, for the child, for Caitlin, and there's the fear of not knowing as a child is going to be born a month earlier than should be. And so we pray for comfort in the fear and anxiety that that causes. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that this child can be born healthy and strong and that it can all be safe. for the praise and glory of your name. We pray, Heavenly Father, for Margaret. Retinal tears are no fun. It's very frightening to think of losing eyesight and the trouble that that is. And so we pray that her visit, though it's a lot longer than expected, can be a good one, and that you protect her eyesight, and that you demonstrate your care for her in this time. We rejoice with the Boonstoppel family, Heavenly Father, that Maya and Ryan, or sorry, Lucas, can be married. We're looking forward to that celebration. We pray that you watch over them, that you sustain them through their married life together, and may Saturday be a celebration of your goodness and your care. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that as all the details, the last-minute details get worked on, that things will fall into place, and that it can be a good celebration. Heavenly Father, we're thankful with Tex and with Mary, or with Tom and with Mary, for the good progress that's been made as he wrestles with cancer, and as it seems the tumor has shrunk, and he has the ability to do things that he enjoys. We pray that you continue to watch over Tom and Mary, and we're thankful with them, and it's really neat to see their joy and their happiness and comfort in you. May you continue to keep them strong and firmly in your hands. We rejoice with Yelcha that she's well enough to be in church today. We pray that you can help her to be strong and mobile again. Continue to watch over her. And speaking of mobility, we kind of miss David Hood when he's not here. He's also somebody who's wrestled with his mobility, a hip that's still uncomfortable despite the surgery. We pray for healing and for strength for him as well. And we pray, Heavenly Father, with thanks for your leading and for your direction. It's a hard thing to pick up and to move to a different spot. And something that we're looking at and Dave is looking at and Tex and Bonnie's daughter. And so we pray, Heavenly Father, that since everything's under your care, that you'll provide exactly what's needed in terms of buying and selling real estate and finding places to live. And we thank you for your leading and for your direction. We pray with thanks, Heavenly Father, that you brought Christopher to a full-time job in Burford. May that be a place where he can thrive and flourish. And now, Heavenly Father, as we have this day ahead of us, we pray that we can rejoice in your goodness, that we can glorify you in what we say and what we do, that as we get together or as we're alone, that all praise and glory will go to you, and that we can rest as appropriate, we can be active where it's good things to do, and that above all, we can recognize and worship you for your providence and for your care, and for the forgiveness and joy we enjoy in Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to continue worshiping God. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 3 of How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds. Let's stand to do that together. People loved by God, lift up your hearts to receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you shalom. Amen.